All right, let's go ahead and get started. I know there's still some people rolling in, but we have a lot to talk about today, so I want to go ahead and get started. Thank you everyone so much for joining the State of Climate Resilient Affordable Housing. My name is Mihir Parikh. I'm a Senior Program Director at Enterprise's Resilience Division. And again, thank you so much for being here today. We have a great panel to discuss the topic from today. And we're also really lucky to have Jacqueline Waggoner, who's the president of Enterprise's Solutions Division, to kick us off with a welcome today. I just want to note that this webinar is being recorded. And if folks have any questions, please put them in the Q&A. We'll be monitoring that throughout the event. And we will also have time to answer your questions towards the end after our panel. Just a quick note about who Enterprise is. We're a national nonprofit focused on the shortage of affordable, healthy, and climate-ready rental homes throughout the country. We focus on this through supporting community development organizations on the ground through programs, technical assistance, and policy advocacy, aggregating and investing in capital in homes and communities, and lastly, building and managing communities ourselves. Since 1982, we've invested about $54 billion and created over 800,000 homes across all 50 states. So that brings us to today. Just a quick look at the agenda. As I mentioned, we're gonna have an intro and a welcome from Jacqueline Waggoner, and then we'll go into our panel discussion with Damon Burns, Charla Blake, and Kelsey Oesmann, three fantastic individuals who are doing really great work. So with that, I want to invite Jacqueline Waggoner, who, as I mentioned, is the president of Enterprise Community Partners Solutions Division. And as the president of our Solutions Division, Jacqueline leads the company's programmatic policy and advisory work in alignment with its strategic priorities, which I outlined before: increasing housing supply, advancing racial equity, and building upward mobility and resilience. Since joining Enterprise in 2005, Jacqueline has served as Vice President of the Southern California market, has testified before Congress on key policy priorities, and led advocacy on critical issues like vouchers and the source of income discrimination, as well as managing our Equitable Path Forward, Enterprise's $3.5 billion initiative to address racial inequities in the real estate industry. So with that, Jacqueline, I'll hand it over to you, and thank you so much for being here.
Well, thank you for the kind introduction, Mihir. And first of all, whoever picked the Supremes to start off with, those who joined late, you missed some good music as we kicked off this call. It's my pleasure to welcome you all here today to discuss the current state of climate resilient affordable housing. Today, you'll hear from leaders in the field about the most urgent needs communities are facing when it comes to adapting properties and our changing climate. And you'll hear about solutions that are already in place to address these needs and absolute solutions we see coming down the road. But first, I'd like to tell you a bit about why this work is so important to Enterprise and the communities we serve from coast to coast. Across this country, some 35 million homes are at risk from climate change, extreme temperatures, severe floods, devastating storms, and scorching wildfires. You've seen in recent weeks, I was just talking about a couple of panelists about the floods in Las Vegas, the scorching heat warnings, and really the push to conserve power and water. The potential costs are colossal. Last year, climate-related events cost this country $145 billion and nearly 700 lives. But behind those numbers lies a startling truth. Climate events do not impact everybody equally. Climate events impact poor communities, and in particular, poor communities of color are often the very last to recover after a major storm sweeps through. And they are often the most vulnerable. Generations of disinvestment threaten the very existence of some of the nation's most climate-imperiled communities. Climate-resilient, affordable housing is not only a financial imperative, it's a moral imperative. Every affordable home should be well-designed and able to withstand effects of changing climate. All across Enterprise, we are putting resilience first, because when we build more resilient communities, we build a better future for everyone. From Hurricane Katrina in the Gulf Coast to Superstorm Sandy in the Northeast to the wildfires in California, we've seen firsthand what happens to communities when we aren't prepared for the next disaster. Let me share with a few ways how I might say solutions that we are working on to reduce climate risk within the affordable housing properties at Enterprise. On the policy front, we are advocating for affordable housing that's built and retrofitted to adapt to and provide protection for climate risks. On the capital side, we are providing funding and financing solutions to make sure affordable housing is built smarter after disaster strikes. We have a disaster accelerator fund, which is reducing the time it takes to relief dollars to reach owners of multifamily affordable rental properties, enabling owners to repair buildings faster, 2 years early nearly than they otherwise could, and ultimately stabilizing communities faster. And through our programs, our Building Resilient Futures team is building the capacity of affordable housing providers to approach development in light of the current and future climate reality. Our vision is for sustainable, resilient, affordable housing to be the norm and the communities to be equipped to withstand and recover from disasters. We are working to bring lower utility bills, clean energy, and healthy, resilient futures to affordable housing communities. One of our longest running programs, Enterprise Green Communities, has saved more than $114 million in energy and water costs for affordable homes. We have a free suite of resources to address climate risk within our properties. Tools like Portfolio Protect allow you to evaluate climate risk within your portfolio. Programs like Green Communities, Keep Safe, and Community Powered Resilience are working with building owners and community members to further climate resilience. I recently spent some time with a housing provider, and I heard from firsthand how it helped support his properties in rural Florida. Today, you'll hear directly from partners who have participated in one of our newest programs, our Resilience Academies. Participants in our academies explore the climate risks of their region, examine how to ensure business continuity in the event of a disaster, explore how to foster social cohesion, which increases disaster survival rates, and incorporate equity as a process rather than just an outcome. So, Enterprise will continue to serve as an intermediary to lift up needs and help deliver solutions with communities while learning about success stories. What you'll hear today is communities that are thirsting for strategies to increase climate resilience and ready to do the work. We will continue to deploy our resilience academies in more regions throughout the country. Join us in New York this fall, 10 years after Hurricane Sandy. And I am so excited that we're talking about this subject today. I can't wait to hear from the panelists. Thank you for making time to hear from us today, and back to me here.
Thank you so much, Jacqueline, for that introduction to our great event today. We really appreciate it. And we appreciate you leading our solutions division and all the work that you mentioned. So thanks again. All right, so with that, I'm going to share our agenda again as we bring on our panelists here. So just logistically how this will work, all of our three panelists will give about 5 minute introduction of themselves and the work that they're doing, and then we'll go into a free-flowing discussion between everyone. And, I just want to reiterate what Jacqueline mentioned about, the folks and really why we're here to discuss, what are the most urgent needs in the affordable housing sector in our communities to address climate risk reduction within housing right now, but also what are some success stories? You'll hear from two owner developers in one in Louisiana, one in Tennessee, who have been focused on this work and really have within their communities created their own success stories, regardless of whatever barriers they might face. And then we'll also hear from a group that is really providing a lot of the solutions right now in the funding and financing world. So with that, I'll invite our panelists to turn on their screens, and we'll start just with introductions with Damon Burns, who is the CEO of Finance New Orleans. And Damon is a New Orleans native and a public finance professional with more than 10 years of experience in entrepreneurship, investment banking, corporate banking, and economic development. I'll let Damon give an overview of what Finance New Orleans actually is. But prior to Finance New Orleans, Damon founded a financial technology company as well as an investment capital group providing resources to minority entrepreneurs and high school students attempting to build technology-based companies. After Hurricane Katrina, Damon served as a program manager for Louisiana's Economic Development $75 million Hurricane Katrina Small Business Recovery Fund, and much, much more. Charla Blake is the executive director of Project Build the Future, a nonprofit based in Lake Charles, Louisiana. Again, I'll let her go further into that, but prior to Project Build the Future, Charla worked as the Arts Council of Southwest Louisiana, and in 2012, relocating back to Louisiana after spending 20 years teaching interior design at the Art Institute of Dallas. And last but not least, Kelsey Oesmann, who is the Director of Design and Development at Urban Housing Solutions, a nonprofit provider of affordable housing in Nashville, Tennessee. Kelsey is a licensed architect, and I love this fact. In 2017, Kelsey biked across the country to raise funds and awareness for affordable housing with the nonprofit Bike and Build. She relocated to Nashville for the Enterprise Community Partners Rose Fellowship and was jointly hosted by Urban Housing Solutions and the Nashville Civic Design Center, contributing to the construction and preservation of more than 500 affordable apartments through 2020. So with that, I will stop sharing my screen and we will... Great. Well, hello, everyone. Thank you again for being here. Charla, why don't you start us off? Tell us a little bit about Project Build the Future and what you view as the state of climate resilient affordable housing in your world right now.
Thank you. Project Build the Future is a 20-year-old nonprofit quality affordable housing agency in Lake Charles, Louisiana. We were started by a Catholic priest who realized that people who were living within his parish were hardworking individuals, but didn't quite make the money or have the means to be able to purchase a home of their own. And so he started in 2001, he started this agency, which was working towards helping people attain home ownership through financial literacy. In 2005, we were hit by Hurricane Rita. And so that sort of changed the course of direction for the agency. There were so many people who needed housing after that they partnered with Habitat for Humanity in the state of Louisiana, a program called the Affordable Housing Pilot Program. And they built about 67 houses, which they then turned around and used as lease to purchase and rental properties to be able to help people move out of FEMA trailers. From then, Project Build a Future has gone on to build over 100, I think we're at 112 houses. And while we're a small agency, I'm proud to say we have a 0% foreclosure rate, that through our financial literacy program and our counseling, our clients are well educated on how to be able to budget and manage their finances to purchase a home of their own through a bank or some other form of lender. In 2020, In 21, we had multiple things which came in and caused upheaval again in our area. So for me, we were at a deficit for quality affordable housing prior to hurricanes of 2020, and we are at an even greater deficit now. We are an oil and gas industry area, and so there is a lot of money to be made here, but there is still not a lot of housing that meets those people who work minimum wage jobs. And so that has been a real cause of concern for us. And as an agency, that's one of our focuses. We have a rental program, but we also build houses for sale. And we are in, we work with a lot of other nonprofits and a lot of other agencies to be able to do that. So climate resilient for me means a couple of things. Of course, it means that we're building to ensure structures withstand climatic conditions and they're able to rebound or bounce back after disasters, such as fortified roofing, envelope methodologies, that sort of thing. That often includes additional costs. Life cycle costing is typically more costly upfront for a rear end return, and that's not always cost effective for our clients. So navigating that challenge is always there. But I think the other thing we have to speak about when we think about climate resilient housing is that our population that lives in an impacted and affected or affected area really has to be able to bounce back and resound and as well. Louisiana people are resilient. People say that all the time. We get knocked down and we pick ourselves back up. But when you have been knocked down 4 and 5 times within a 12-month time period, then it starts to become a little challenging as well. And so I think we don't need to forget the people that are associated with the climatic changes that happen in our community. When you have schools, churches, community buildings that continue to be damaged 2 years out, because we're rounding the corner on 2 years from Hurricane Laura, you'll see in some slides that I put together, there are some buildings that still have blue roofs. People are still living in houses that they probably shouldn't be. And that's due to the resiliency of our community, but it is extremely challenging whenever you've been knocked down that many times and you have this much to rebuild back. So for us, climate resilience, or for me, climate resilience is both of those. It's making sure that our buildings maintain the structural capacity that we need to, but it's also making sure that we take care of the people within our community to be able to make sure that they bounce back and proceed with our community as well. Just to give you guys a little bit of background, in August of 2020, which was less than 1 month from the 16th year anniversary of Hurricane Rita, Hurricane Laura hit. Louisiana law states that residents have up to 24 months after a damage to file suit against insurance companies. So today we're 9 days away from that 2 year anniversary. October 10th, 2020, Hurricane Delta hit 6 weeks later in a 30-mile different path, but pretty much followed the same course as Hurricane Laura. In February of 2021, we had a freak winter ice storm where we were without power for about a week, and people who were rebuilding had an additional issue. In May of 2021, we had historic floodings in areas that were not flood zones and areas that had not flooded previously within our city. So if you managed to not be impacted by one of the two hurricanes or the ice storm, lots of people were impacted by flooding. And then in October, we had tornadoes which tore through here. We're on the western side of the state. And if you look at the eastern side of the state, in October of 2020, Hurricane Zeta hit. And in August of 2021, on the 16th anniversary of Hurricane Katrina, Hurricane Ida hit. So Louisiana has been bombarded in the past 2 years with 6 and 7 disasters. I think there may have been a swarm of locusts that came through at some point, and frogs might have hailed from the sky as well. We were looking for anything and combating everything at that moment. What that has forced us to do, however, is through partners like Community Foundation of Southwest Louisiana, and donors and people who donated to them for rebuilding purposes, we have been lucky enough to form some guidelines for resilient housing, fortified roofing, fortified envelope methodologies, as well as trying to figure out how to cover the cost for those. Because as we mentioned, that's always going to be an extra struggle. The population that we serve, my organization, is the low to moderate income clientele, and they were oftentimes not insured or extremely underinsured. And for those of you who may not live in a hurricane prone zone, then there are stipulations oftentimes in your house insurance that if it is a named storm, your deductible rises by incremental rates. So my agency was lucky. We didn't have a named storm policy. We paid a flat fee on every property that we had that was damaged. but I had friends who had $40,000 and $50,000 deductibles because they had a name storm addendum in their policy. So you're looking at paying that out of pocket before you're ever helped to be paid back at first. So that increases your distaste for what happens after that point and how you have to go about rebuilding. Not only did we lose a lot of housing stock, because I think they estimated between 44 and 47,000 homes were damaged, which is about half the population of the city of Lake Charles, were damaged due to both hurricanes, and a third of those needed major repair. We suffered a lot of homelessness. We suffered a lot of people who moved out of our area because they were maybe older and their children lived somewhere else. And they said, no, okay, enough is enough in the last several years. 74 of 76 schools within our parish were damaged. So then you also had to worry about where children were receiving their education, how parents were handling that. And all that was amidst COVID, which impacted everybody in 2020 as well. The other thing that has come back a year after the fact, or in 2 years after the fact, is that there was an estimated $1.1 billion in loss of revenue through the timber agencies and industries here in Louisiana. So that means that 2 years out, rebuilding has become extremely expensive because all of the timber that we would have used is no longer. That was enough timber to run 25 timber mills for a year. So we are way behind, not to mention the fact that COVID closed some industries down, and there was a lag behind. So rebuilding has been slow because we are suffering from that. There were an estimated 400 to 500 homes that were damaged in the floods. Some people had rebuilt from Hurricane Laura and Delta and then had to suffer damage from a flood and rebuild for a third time. What that has also caused is that there are lots of insurance agencies which are pulling out of the state of Louisiana, or they are not insuring or not renewing policies. I come from Cameron Parish, which is along the coast, and I have friends who still live there. In 2021, one of my friends' flood insurance policy was a maximum policy at $750. His flood insurance increased this year to $5,980. And that's on an incremental plan for the next 5 years. So his flood insurance will raise even more, but that's what it raised in 1 year. And the rate increases are 40 to 50%. And that's because several insurance companies went out of business because of the four hurricanes within a little over a year time span. And parts of Cameron Parish still have no power. They are running off of generator power through Jeff Davis Electric. So not everyone 2 years out has received all the utilities that they need. In the newspaper today, there was an article stating that energy customers would pay $3.2 billion to reimburse that company for repair cost. And what that translates into is I had friends who 3 months ago had a utility bill of $350 and this month have a $1,000 utility bill. So resiliency for energy efficiency, resiliency for bouncing back as far as the construction industry is important. But even if you have a house, trying to bounce back from going from a $300 a month utility bill to a $1,000 a month utility bill is going to be hard. And a lot of people can't afford that. And so we have seen some people, as I mentioned, who have moved from our community, but that then increases the amount of people who need assistance and who need additional monies to be able to make their affordable housing work. The Community Foundation put together a resilient housing toolkit. And I think there's a couple of representatives from that agency on the call. And so we'll try to drop that link in the chat for you. But it is a very simple, forward-thinking pamphlet that lets any homeowner know what they need to talk to their contractor about as far as for fortified roofing or other ways to be able to stop some damages. We're building to hurricane standards. We are doing fortified roofs. We are building to Miami-Dade standards. And so we're trying to meet all the requirements to be resilient here. But again, I think when you look at the instances that happen outside of just traditional damage as you see it, the timber industry, the people who moved, people who lost their jobs due to COVID, all of those impacting us at once. The resiliency of this community has to be really strong. And I will end my session, my section by saying that I went to school with Susie Fauber, who's from Grand Chenier. And Susie said, as long as there is a Grand Chenier, there will be a Fauber on Grand Chenier, because there was one when it was formed and she is going back. So the resiliency of this community lies in the hearts of people like Susie Fauber. She is not going to let 4 hurricanes, 5 hurricanes, locust, whatever it is, deter her from coming back. And I think that if we have that strength in people, then that needs to be matched in the strength of our buildings, and our communities can stay strong after that.
Thank you so much, Charla. You know, just as it was when you and I connected through our resilience academies focused on the Gulf Coast, and you know, a couple of weeks ago, your story of like Charles and everyone in Cameron Parish and everywhere else you said really sticks, and it takes a lot of time to process. And we just really appreciate you sharing your story with us. I want to make sure we have good enough time for Kelsey and Damon to give an intro to themselves, and then we can move on to a more of a discussion. So Kelsey, I'll welcome you to give a quick intro and tell us about how you feel about the state of climate resilient housing in Tennessee.
Sure, thanks, Mayor. So my name is Kelsey Oesmann. I'm with Urban Housing Solutions. We are also a nonprofit affordable housing provider. We are based in Nashville and only work in Nashville-Davidson County. We are a long-term owner operator. So our portfolio has grown from when we started in 1991 with the first permanent supportive housing project, serving folks who were transitioning from homelessness. And that continues to be kind of at the core of what we do, serving those specific housing needs that that create an additional barrier. As you might imagine, in Nashville, the market is bonkers right now. And so we are also just seeing incredible pressure on average working folks. And so our portfolio and our pipeline have kind of evolved over the past 30 years to just respond to what's happening here in Nashville. So some of that has included focusing on resilience. Nashville has had its fair share of disasters and other events over even just my time here since 2017. A lot of it has been related to severe storms, so often flooding or wind damage. We had a major tornado come through in 2020. Recovery from that was obviously hampered by the pandemic. But we have also started to see a lot more extreme heat impacts. And so thinking about, you know, the future projects, which is really where I sit in our real estate development department, is you know, how do we build housing that's able to withstand those, and how do we equip our staff and residents to respond effectively? I think where our challenge has become more apparent is in retrofitting our existing portfolio. A lot of the housing that we have and manage has, you know, is a 1960s to 80s vintage. And so finding ways to work with what we've got on those properties requires an extra level of creativity and investment. So that's kind of where we are focusing next. I think we have a fairly good grasp on how to make sure that the product that we're bringing on the market is responsive to all those different challenges as much as we can be. But looking back at our, again, our existing properties, the retrofit has definitely been a bigger challenge.
Thank you, Kelsey. And yeah, I know maybe at some point in the future, we can have you back and you can share the presentation you shared with us about, I think, post the tornado and the severe storms you had with the severe lightning strikes and all the damage to the properties that caused. You shared that with our Southeast Resilience Academy. So that was just, I think, very eye-opening, because we don't often think about lightning when we're thinking about storms and all these other things, but the damage that you all suffered from that was definitely eye-opening. So appreciate the intro. All right. Last but not least, Damon. Thank you for being here. And yeah, please tell us about Finance New Orleans.
Sure. Thank you, Mia. And thank you to everyone out there for your time and attention. I'm Damon Burns of Finance New Orleans. Finance New Orleans is the city of New Orleans' housing finance agency. That's where we've been historically. In recent years, we've also become their green bank or green finance authority. And the reason why we became the city's green bank is because we went through our own climate challenges as an organization alongside the city. During Hurricane Katrina, such a massive event, it not only affected private homeowners, it affected businesses, but it of course had a big impact on the public sector, which we're still recovering from. And then after Katrina, you had the recession, you had the BP oil spill, you had a number of storms and other weather events that have happened, culminating with COVID. So it's been 15 years of event after event and challenge after challenge. So our resiliency has been directly challenged. And kind of like Charlotte said, the definition of resilience varies. And it's a lot broader than it sounds on the surface sometimes. So from a physical standpoint, we were primarily invested in single family housing or single family home ownership when Katrina happened. 90% of our portfolio was in that sector, if you will. And we had about a $400 million portfolio, which shrank by 90% overnight. And that was a direct result of our communities being destroyed by Hurricane Katrina and the inability of us to recover quickly because the infrastructure just wasn't in that condition at that point in time. So families moved, they relocated, they sold their homes, they went to new neighborhoods, they moved to other cities within the state, they moved far away from New Orleans. And all of these things were reflected in our financial condition. And our financial condition is important because that's how we create an impact in the city. We use public finance as a tool to stimulate investment in our community. So as we've gone out to reimagine ourselves and to create a new vision so that we can continue the impact that we had in some of our earlier decades of existence, we started out with the city's most pressing problem, which is climate, which is resilience. So without us solving climate and resilience, there is no city. No city can survive without a plan for dealing with the natural environment. And so our plan for dealing with the natural environment as we move forward with our investment plans for the city is to ensure that all of our dollars are tied to some sort of climate resilience or equity in our communities that can have a lasting impact. We've rebuilt our core programs. I mentioned before that we were focused primarily on single family. We've expanded from not only single family, but to multifamily or development programs, as well as green infrastructure programs, so that we can have a holistic approach to addressing our community's financing needs. Also, we needed a blueprint for how we are to invest moving forward. So we looked at the city's climate plan, which was done in 2015, and it had a few different iterations since it was originally released. But one of the things that was missing from that climate plan was an overall financial strategy. So how do you actually bring green projects to life? What do they look like? What types of projects do those include? What kind of industries are those in? Who are the partners that are needed in order to execute those projects? What are some of the policies that we as a public agency need? All of these were unanswered questions. And we did a lot of R&D with the help of C40 Cities and the City of New Orleans and other agencies to come up with what we call the Resilient New Orleans Finance Plan. And that finance plan is our Bible for resiliency in the city moving forward. Especially at Finance New Orleans, our strategic plan is based directly on that Resilient New Orleans Finance Plan. So what that means in practice is as we finance multifamily developments, ensuring that they have green building standards, like enterprise green communities, and making sure that they actually go through that process and get that certification so that we can validate to the community that we're putting up buildings that should stand the test of time. And also on the single family side, some of the things that we're learning through the implementation of our new green mortgage program, which not only helps the family get into a home, but it also helps them address the resiliency issues around the home. You know, having a product is one thing, but educating the community on how to use it is the harder work. And you know, that's where we are at the moment, which is introducing new concepts to the community, introducing new programs. The use cases are being developed in real time because people are starting to come to us to say, hey, during last storm, my power was out for 2 weeks. Tell me about solar panels. Tell me about battery storage. So the community is starting to come to us and asking us how to fulfill some of these ideas. So there's a long way to go in terms of actually bringing these elements to life, but there is some positive momentum. We've done 6 deals in the past couple of years. All of them have green community, enterprise green community standards attached to them. So that's a great start, but we need to keep infiltrating the community with sustainability standards and doing it hand by hand with the community because they're the ones experiencing it on a day-to-day basis. So homeowners, developers, businesses, public agencies, et cetera, can all benefit from this platform that we're building. And it's intentionally large, it's intentionally wide-reaching because that's what our community needs and that's what many communities need at the time. So we have to evolve with it and we just have to step up as a governmental agency to address the challenges of today's world.
Thank you, Damon. I want to bring everyone back on in here now. So, you know, just to kind of start off for our discussion, I mean, the three of you as individuals, as the communities that you live in and serve, have been through a lot when it comes to climate events, right? I mean, that was my first, after hearing the three of you talk, you know, it again, takes a second to settle in. And sadly, it's the norm for most people throughout the country now with our changing climate. The second thing I hear is that Kelsey and Charla, as owners, operators, developers, you clearly want to be investing in your homes that you're building or rebuilding in the right way so that when the inevitable next event does come, your residents will be safer, the time that it takes to recover will be shorter. From an investment and a capital standpoint, there will be less loss, hopefully. So I guess the question I have to start off for Kelsey and Charla, and then I'd love to bring Damon back in on this, is what are some barriers to you both right now where you clearly want to do it? That's without question. As individuals, you are resilient, your communities are resilient, but we can't, Charla, back to your point, can we really ask people to keep being resilient who go through these time and time again? So I'd just love to hear from you both to start off with what are some things that are not holding you back, but sort of in your way to reach these goals that you're trying to reach?
For me, I can tell you it's the cost of construction currently. What I could build for prior to the hurricanes has increased tremendously. The same house that I was building for about $130 a square foot is now $160 to $170 a square foot. So that $135,000 house is now $205,000. And I'm still selling, I'm selling it at a loss. So my clients and my community can't afford that. So gap funding. So that's been challenging to try to get. Now I will say we have a very giving community and I've reached out to several organizations, lenders, philanthropic entities, and we've received a bunch of gap funding, but will that happen every year? And at some point this will become the norm. As we mentioned, building resiliently costs more upfront for a rear end savings. So if I already have a client who can't afford a $150,000 house, and now I'm going to add on some additional cost to save them in the long run to increase the cost of that house, how can they benefit from that? Who can help them? And Louisiana is looking at right now giving you insurance credits if you have fortified roofing, but there is an additional cost to get a fortified roof. So if I already have a hard time getting a roof or buying a house that is fortified, then I'm increasing my cost. So I think we have to look at both sides of the coin. There's help out there, but sometimes the help comes at a cost. And then we have to think about how the people who need it the most are going to be the people who can still achieve it. Mm-hmm. So right now for us, it's cost of construction and cost of just living here has risen tremendously. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'll second that cost challenge. And I think some of it is that you know, we have had success in leveraging the typical sources to build housing, but to go that extra step, if it doesn't already fit within the project portfolio, then you know, making the case for these additional investments when essentially the proof then is that nothing happens, right? Like success is that people are safe and stable, and that we don't have to then seek funding to recover and rebuild, or at least not as much. But making that case to funders, I think has also been a challenge, and finding the right partners who are able and willing to get on board with that. And it just adds one extra layer of complexity to an already very complicated project process.
Yeah. And I guess on that same note of what are some barriers, you know, Damon, just the end of what you were saying about how now the community is coming to you for some of these resources and saying, sort of like Charla and Kelsey are saying, like, we want to do this, we're invested in it, and you're already providing solutions. So I guess my question to you would be, what do you suggest that communities like Nashville or like Charles, how would you suggest to bring them along in sort of the solutions that you're providing to get to the point where the community is coming to you and say, we want more products like this to help the gap financing, the gap funding?
Sure. Three things stand out. One is the community demand, which is starting to be validated. That has been a roadblock because we've been introducing ideas or different products to the community. And you know, there are the early adopters, just like in any product. But you know, the community needs can be difficult to pin down sometimes. So, you know, the community engagement has started to pick up, and the awareness is growing on its own, without us even having some kind of substantial marketing campaign. And then I would say, secondly, is the financing that is available to actually make these projects work. So the Inflation Reduction Act is going to go a long way in giving a shot in the arm to climate resilience, particularly through public agencies like ours that have lined up projects and have an interest in making green infrastructure a reality in our communities, because many cities haven't done it yet. So we're building that playbook as we go, but the financing is definitely needed in order to successfully execute these projects. And then thirdly, I would say the technology, the green technology, or just the overall technology is needed in order to address resiliency, because that's a big part of this equation. If you're talking about solar panels or stormwater management or some kind of smart city technology or microgrid or even a nature-based solution, that's still technology. And so many of the technologies that are needed to address resiliency are still in their infancy. So I think the Inflation Reduction Act will play a role in stimulating that space. There's some new provisions for credits and the equity that's going to come in these kind of projects. There's still some work to be done on the public finance debt side. You know, a green bond is no different than a regular bond at the moment. So there's still some work to be done in order to address those issues. But I would say community engagement, financing, and technology are three of the biggest barriers at the moment. And the bonus one will be policy, just making sure we have a local policy and the national policy to accommodate for these types of investments. And that's not always the case for many of these project types.
Kelsey, I saw you nodding your head to the last one. Anything to add in there?
Yeah, I think that policy piece is so important, because it can also enable the financing. In 2020, finished our first project that has rooftop solar on it. And at the end of that year, the program that was supporting that in Tennessee expired. And so it's just not financially feasible for us to do solar right now in Tennessee. And so I think, you know, we in Nashville have come a long way with our stormwater management requirements, but it's so much easier to justify things that are baked into code or local regulations, and aren't seen necessarily as us trying to kind of go above and beyond and be super creative and innovative. And then it's also a way to scale solutions, because our building, our property can only do so much, and we know that these events impact neighborhoods and regions. And so it has to really be that kind of scale of solution as well.
Charla, anything to add in? I saw you nodding your head as well. So
I would say the same thing, because we're looking at doing some resilient roofing on the three houses that we have under construction right now. But there is no one in my community who actually is certified to proclaim them as such. We have to get someone from either Lafayette, which is 60 miles in one direction, or Beaumont, 60 miles in another, to potentially come and do that. So with that policy also comes education of the construction industry. It also has to become a norm. People have to understand the importance. And so it's not a quick fix. We can't just say, let's all do fortified roofing and everybody do them and the insurance companies take my word for it. So that is a process. And I think that everybody's working towards that. And that's great, but it does take a little bit of time. And so trying to figure out what the best options are. And as Damon mentioned, there are so many things going on right now that are in the infancy stages, trying to figure out which one is best for what situation, which one is the most cost effective, how do you pass it on? What is the longevity of that is important, but as long as we continue, and we have to use precedences like the Miami-Dade. I mean, they show that their buildings are actually holding up better. We've seen some opportunities for fortified roofing in some hurricanes that happened here recently where fortified roofing communities were not damaged while communities a block over had no roofs left. But we're gathering all that evidence now, and it just takes a little time, but it definitely does have to become something that everybody's on board about to make sure that it works, or else the insurance component is going to be astronomical and cost prohibitive, and there would be no reason. It doesn't matter if I have a fortified roof. If I don't have any money to insure my house, that doesn't matter. So, you know, lots of things dovetail together.
And so I guess, so staying on that point of, Charla, your example of the there's no one to inspect the roof to certify that it is a fortified roof in your area, right? That's a capacity building issue in some sense, right? And I think when we talk about climate resilient housing and communities, we often talk about capacity building. But what do we really mean by that, right? I mean, there's educational capacity to the point that you mentioned, Charla. There's financial capacity, which Damon is helping to provide, and obviously physical capacity from a staffing standpoint. So I'm curious from Kelsey and Charla's standpoint to what are some solutions, because we've talked a lot about the needs, but what are some solutions that you are either implementing or seeing right now to address that capacity standpoint? And then Damon, I'd also love to get your thoughts on that after from things that you're already providing or maybe suggestions to, you know, owners, operators of affordable housing that they can take advantage of?
Well, for us, I think organizations like the Community Foundation here have the ear of the whole community, governmental bodies, philanthropic organizations, and the public. And so the fact that they have deemed it to be something that we need to look at provides a validity to that. And so they are working on putting out information. They're working on, as part of a cohort group, we're looking at how that educational process would work, who needs to be involved in that, then what the next steps are for city planning and those things. And also, I, as you mentioned, I'm an agency of five people. I can't have somebody who is a specialist in everything here. But if I am one organization out of 20, and then all 20 of us need somebody, then there is a capacity building for maybe someone at the city or the parish or the state level to be able to assist organizations like mine. So it becomes a trickle-down effect at some point. And I think when you do have organizations like Damon's, like Kelsey's, who are the voices of the people that they serve and their community at large, backed by people like community foundations, Baton Rouge Area Foundation, organizations that look at what and collect money for what is the betterment of their community, then I think you're on the right path. That helps you move in that direction, because my agency doesn't have the money to be able to do that, but they do, and they listen to us, and they're there for us to bend our ear, you know, their ear. And so that's an important part of the process, I think.
Yeah, I want to pull on that that thread of like peer learning, because I think when we started to put together our own kind of disaster preparedness plan, reached out to some of our peer agencies in town, be like, what does your plan look like? Nobody had one. So so it wasn't necessarily something that we could like model ours based off of the success or learnings from another agency, especially within Nashville, which I think having that kind of hyper-local context is really important, not just for the particular climate risks that we're facing here, but just the political, economic, community, culture context. But I think having that, you know, that's, I think, why the Resilience Academy was so great, that you had that cohort of being able to say, like, we tried this, it didn't work, don't bother. Or we tried this and like, it was almost there, tweak this one thing and it might be great. So I think that kind of collaboration across agencies, and ideally there is a public you know, metro city-based entity or person that is kind of shepherding that. Nashville did have, we were one of the 100 resilient cities. We unfortunately lost our chief resilience officer, and obviously that initiative is no longer, but having that kind of point person to help rally folks. We've been connected with our VOAD, it's the Voluntary Organizations Active in Disaster. And that has been a valuable place for that kind of conversation.
And I will say, I was just corrected by a friend of mine who said, wait, we do fortified roofing and we do certification, so we're going to talk. So there's already things happening about that. And I would also be remiss in saying that, thank you for asking me to be here today, but organizations such as Enterprise have allowed for capacity building for my agency. And so the information and the assistance that you guys provide is extremely important to organizations like mine. We did get a grant 2 years ago for a consultant to help us write a COOP, a disaster, you know, plan. And so that was important because, as Kelsey mentioned, we've been through this before, but none of us ever had one because we didn't think it was going to happen again this soon. And kind of like childbirth, you forget how painful it is once it's all over and done with, until the next time it comes around. And so we didn't have that, but organizations such as Enterprise are important for the resiliency of agencies such as mine and the capacity building. So thank you for that.
Well, we appreciate you saying that. And, you know, we're definitely the lucky ones. We've learned so much from groups like yours and Kelsey's and Damon's. And, you know, I think the listening and learning from each other is really the only way to move all this forward. We have a bunch of questions in the Q&A. So I just want to make sure we have some time to get to a few of them. I believe this question is for Damon. Damon, is Finance New Orleans financing any training or workforce development in the green building sector?
We don't have a formal program at the moment, but what we've done is engaged our third-party partners, program partners, to have them deliver workforce development services. We actually make it a part of our agreement or our arrangement with our consultants or third-party service providers that they help us address workforce issues in the community. As an example, for our green mortgage program, we've partnered with Entergy, which is our local utility company, and their rebates and incentives built in to our program that come directly from Entergy's resilience program or single-family resilience program, Energy Smart. And they also have the ability and the option for us to provide training to interested contractors that want to learn how to install energy efficiency improvement, energy efficiency equipment, et cetera. So all of those things are, you know, they're happening organically right now. In the future, we would like to do more formal training. And then the other aspect I will say that's going towards workforce development right now is the fact that we are investing in DBE businesses, and more specifically DBE developers. And in New Orleans, that means disadvantaged business enterprises. So what that usually results in are Black-owned businesses, women-owned businesses. We have a very strong Vietnamese community in New Orleans. We have a growing Hispanic population. So there are different groups that fall into the DBE category. And we're making a concerted effort to ensure that those DBE developers are getting an opportunity to lead deals that are enterprise green communities or that have those standards attached to them. It's a high level of standard that has to be reached. And many times in our community, just frankly, we haven't prioritized investment in DBEs. We haven't prioritized investment in BIPOC communities, if you will. So it's important that these aspects are built into our policies, into our program requirements. Mm-hmm. And so those are some of the things that we're doing at the moment in lieu of having a formal training program. But we are in search of some community partners that can offer that formal training and that can plug companies or contractors directly into the projects, especially as the pipeline gets bigger moving forward.
Thanks, Tim. And yeah, well, I think that was the call to action or call for partners. If there's any partners out there that can meet that, we'll send out Damon's contact info with the recording and everything for this. I want to get to one more here. Kelsey, for you, how are you funding retrofits specifically for flooding and tornado risks in LIHTC projects?
That's a great question, and I don't have a great answer. We have not done it yet. We are looking at the possibility of a scattered site LIHTC because we do have, most of our portfolio is smaller, you know, 20 to 40 unit properties that wouldn't be able to support LIHTC on their own, but haven't quite gotten there yet. We've also been looking at the PACE program, the Property Assessed Clean Energy Lending. There's a couple local partners, and I think Tennessee actually just passed legislation to allow that tool to be used here. So knowing that there are eligible uses geared towards resilience in that program, those are the two kind of methods that we're looking at. We do have one property that we are currently trying to see if there's a way to work with the city and really like all city agencies on a potential land swap to get this housing out of the floodplain and replace it or rebuild it somewhere else. So those are just a couple of strategies we're looking at.
Thanks, Kelsey. With the minute we have left, I'd love to give you each, we'll do a lightning round of 30 seconds of what is making you feel hopeful about the future in terms of the properties, your residents, your communities, and addressing climate risk within the communities that you all live and work in. Charla, let's start with you.
The giving nature of my community. I've reached out to several entities for assistance, and they've all come back with what I asked for or more. And so I think they understand the importance of what we need, and they want to continue to be resilient in the community too. So it's that spirit of giving here in our community. Even if they have a dollar, they'll give you 50 cents, if not the whole dollar left, because they want the community to come back.
Thank you. Damon?
On that same note, our community here in New Orleans is becoming more and more aware of what the community needs and also what they want the community to look like. What kind of city do we want to have? What's the quality of life? And setting a higher level of standards and expectations for ourselves. So I'm hopeful that we'll continue down that path. And on the other end of the spectrum, it's having the federal funding and the policies starting to come around that will enable this investment. There's going to be a lot more needed over the next 20, 30, 40 years, but this is a good start. And I think the momentum is in our favor. When I say our, I mean the people on this line, the people that care about this kind of stuff. And we're going to have the resources more and more to make those investments.
Thanks, Damon. Kelsey, finish us out here.
Yeah, I think it is really about the resilience of people and our communities transitioning into advocacy and activism. We're seeing a lot more legislation that's actually reaching a productive point in our process, and that's a challenge in Tennessee. So really excited to see the kind of grassroots organizing leading to actual policy change.
Thanks. All right. We are unfortunately at time. I feel like I could talk to the three of you for the rest of the day, but we'll let everyone get on with their day. So thank you so much again for coming on, sharing your stories, your needs, your successes, and the solutions that you're all providing to to protect the homes that you're building and the residents that live in them. So thank you so much again, Kelsey, Damon, Charla, and Jacqueline, all for being here. And we will send out this link to this recording. And oh, great, Jacqueline, you're still here. And we'll hope to see you all for our New York Resilience Academy in the fall, and then looking to continue going around the country to different regions for the next couple of years. So thank you again, the three of you, so much. This is really fantastic. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Take care, all.